Welcome everybody to this episode of the translational series. So today we will have a brief overview on the dendritic cells in immunotherapy, and we will touch a little bit on let's say the challenges and need for cellular product manufacturing. So here is a little bit the agenda for the day. So as you can see, we'll have this little overview, and then we will discuss a little bit about or dive into some innovative technology that will allow you to employ primary dendritic cells for preclinical and clinical research. And then finally, we will speak of some tools that might optimize your cellular vaccine production and also the quality control for your cellular product. We will finish up with a little bit of a glimpse in the future of dendritic cells in immunotherapy, and then you will have a little bit of time for some Q&A if you have some more questions. So these are some abbreviations that we will use today. I'm pretty much sure that probably you all know them, but you can then find them here in the legend, just if you need them as a reference in the future when you're going to look through this webinar again. So let's dive in, and let's start with the overview on the past and present of the dendritic cells in the clinical setting. So 40 years since their discovery, dendritic cells have been recognized as central players in the immune regulation. At the same time, our understanding of vaccines and immune responses have progressed thanks to some of the pioneering work done in this field. So if we start from the work of Taidi, Romani, and Nestle, for example, they pioneered the field in the early 90s, we see that we started to generate ex vivo dendritic cells for immunotherapy. And then if you go a little bit further away in the middle of the 90s, we have the first antigen-loaded dendritic cell studies coming up. And after this, in the late of the 90s, the first progenitor-derived dendritic cells were being used in cancer studies. And in this case, we speak of either MODC or also hematopoietic cell progenitor-derived dendritic cells. At this point, in the early 2000s, some studies started also to evaluate how to optimize DC vaccine development, and also in the field expanded not only in the vaccine production, but also in induction of tolerance for some new finding that was showing that dendritic cells had a role also in inducing tolerance. In the late 2000s, we started also to have the first xenoantigen and tumor-derived RNA-loaded dendritic cells to be used for vaccine therapy. And obviously, some of these studies were very important for the field in general. And finally, we started also to use adjuvant and dendritic cells in combined strategies, for example, by combining checkpoint inhibitors or chemotherapy with dendritic cells as adjuvant in this treatment to improve the vaccine potency. And lately, just in the last kind of 5 years, we can say that blood-derived myeloid dendritic cells and plasmacytoid dendritic cells have been employed in vaccination strategies. So if we look at the dendritic cells in immunotherapy, you can see that in the last 20 years since the start in this field, the gold standard has been to derive the dendritic cells from progenitors and to mature them with, for example, cytokine cocktails mainly. But now, and only in the last 5 years, we started to be able to use primary blood-derived dendritic cells because the number was compatible with vaccine production. And this was not possible before because there were not a single strategy that would have allowed to use dendritic cells that are in such a low number in the human blood. But let's see why dendritic cells are so important. So although multiple antigen-presenting cells are able to cross-present antigens, dendritic cells are the most efficient to do so, especially in the context of CD8 T cells responses. And this is because of their ability to provide both the signal 1 and the signal 2. So signal 1 being the TCR-MHC signal, and signal 2 coming from the coreceptor. And these allow the dendritic cells to produce also extra signal that are known as a signal tree, that would be the presence of a soluble factor. And how this happens in immune responses is in this way. So dendritic cells will scout the environment and will get in contact with most likely some antigen that are recognized through recognition receptors. There are different pattern recognition receptors on the surface of dendritic cells, and this pattern receptor has different intracellular pathways, and they can activate both the costimulatory molecules on the dendritic cell side, but also they can induce the production of soluble factors. And different PRRs make a different release of cytokines. And these act on the T cells in a different way. So the dendritic cells are able to induce both a Th1 polarizing cytokine set, and in this case, they will polarize the T cells towards a Th1 profile that is kind of the one that is considered the most interesting for cancer vaccine, for example, but they can also polarize in a Th2 way by production, for example, of IL-4. So since Jenner founded immunology, and more recently the contribution of Janeway, the mechanism that underlie the immune responses and introduced the concept of pathogen recognition, the role of the dendritic cells as main inducers and regulators of the immunity has been kept in the center of the interest for immunology, and especially also the so-called little dirty secret of vaccination. So if we think of how a vaccine works without the dendritic cells, as I told you, recognize the bacteria, or recognize also tumor cells. They scout the environment and they sense the presence of these. And it might be that these are in combination with adjuvant and might be present, for example, from other sources, but they can also be produced directly from either the bacteria or the tumor cells. And these together are recognized by the dendritic cells that get activated and finally produce soluble factor and allow the priming of naive T cells. And these naive T cells obviously will clonally expand and they will give an immune response. But the dendritic cells can be also used in this way to produce a vaccine or to be used in, for example, adjuvant settings to improve the some of the therapies that are available at the moment. And this is because of their properties. Obviously, people have started to fuse all these things and make use of dendritic cells and the different adjuvants and tumor antigen, for example, to the production of cellular vaccines. So there are some obviously challenges when we speak of cellular vaccines or ATMPs. And for example, there are standard processes that needs to be respected. And in this case, we speak of business and partnership and validations that need to be run and put in place before we start even to think of the production of a cellular product. And there are issues with manufacturing a supply chain, for example, the instruments needed, the GMP processes that need to be in place. And especially important and also a little bit more difficult to deal with might be the legal and regulatory requirements that are really a little bit an issue sometimes because they are really run locally and there are some indication from the bigger body like the FDA or the European Union, but the every state then usually have some little differences. And it might be a little bit different how you have to, for example, deal with the trial design, some of the compliances, and this make a little bit difficult with the approval of therapy. So these are some of the things that you will have to deal with. There are all these kind of words that you will come in contact when you have to develop or manufacture an ATMPs. And obviously, this is not a place for discussing this, but you can find more information in the previous webinar for this series that will show you a little bit more in details what are some of the legal requirements for the development of a cellular product. Despite these challenges, dendritic cells are highly studied in the current situation. As you can see, these are some of some numbers that are taken from clinicaltrials.gov about the trial that are running if you look for DC therapy as a query. So as you can see, there is active interest in the field of dendritic cells immunotherapy. some of the results that we can draw from this previous work on DC immunotherapy is that, for example, most important thing is that the clinical trials so far have established a proof of principle for the use of dendritic cells in immunotherapy. And in fact, an immune response was observed in more than 50% of the treated patient. This translated to what is important for why dendritic cells vaccine are getting more important is, for example, that they are safe, so they have a safety profile for the treatment, and also because DC vaccines are able to influence not only the extent but also the quality of the immune response. Another feature that is very important for the development of a therapeutic tool is the compatibility with combination therapy, for example. So it has been clear now, or it became clear now, that cellular therapy alone, it might not be the resolving technology for some of the diseases, but it most likely the best way to produce a vaccine is to mix some different therapeutic approaches. And this DC therapy has been shown to be obviously able to be combined, for example, with checkpoint inhibitors. And obviously, with the trial running, the protocols have been simplified and the manufacturing processes have been also made faster. So the time constraint is much less of a burden nowadays. We can see from this chart that dendritic cells have been mainly used for solid cancer at the moment, especially in melanoma, prostate cancer, but also renal cell carcinoma and glioma. But there have been also obviously some studies in hematological cancers and tumor, and also dendritic cells have been started to be used for, as I was saying before, tolerogenic studies, so also in the context of inflammation. So let's go on and see a little bit about how to produce a cellular product and how to manufacture a cellular product. And we will focus on the Clinimax platform in this particular case. So what is the workflow? What is needed for the study, the preclinical or clinical study of or development of cellular vaccines? So first of all, we need a sample preparation. We need a way to separate and prepare the tumor lysates and the antigen to give to the dendritic cells. We need a cell separation or a way to separate the cells that we want to use for the cellular product. So it's a way to obtain the dendritic cells, to study specific subsets of dendritic cells, and also to evaluate therapeutic tools. Then we need also a cell culture product. We need to put the cells in culture because dendritic cells need growth factor and cytokines for survival and activation. We need some of them to differentiate and mature more disease, for example, but also for activate, for example, primary dendritic cells. And sometimes they are needed for tuning the dendritic cells' functions to specific responses. And finally, we need also analysis tool that allow the identification of disease subsets for factor flow cell sorting in case we want to isolate very minute, small, rare subpopulation, and also to check the activation and maturation status of the cells, and to have an overview also on functional outcomes of the cells once they've been prepared. So now I will show you a little bit about some of the ways and the product that are available out there for these. So let's start from where we get the dendritic cells. So dendritic cells can come obviously from tissues, but obviously these dendritic cells are not the ones that are usually exploited for a cellular vaccination because they are not in number sufficient and they're not really reachable for a clinician. And then there are dendritic cells in blood. It can be from PBMCs, from whole blood, or from cord blood. And so we can either separate the primary dendritic cells that are present in the blood, or we can differentiate them from a progenitor, as we will see in a second. So on one side, we can get the dendritic cells from the blood. In the blood, we know that we have three different subsets of dendritic cells: the plasmacytoid dendritic cells, the cross-presenting CD141 or XCR1 positive dendritic cells, that is part of the myeloid dendritic cells, and the CD1C myeloid dendritic cell subset. If we want to start from progenitors, we might want to start from monocytes. Monocytes come from peripheral blood. They are in higher number compared to the dendritic cells, and that's why they've been employed to isolate for isolation and then for subsequent differentiation to monocyte-derived dendritic cells. And finally, we can also derive them from hematopoietic stem cell progenitors, i.e. CD34 positive cells in the blood, and these can be used for the differentiation in all the different subsets, including the Langerhans cells. And there are protocols in the literature that are already published for all these different subsets, for example. If you want more information, every time that you will see these kind of buttons, these are linked to more information on this particular subject. So, for example, in this case, you can find a poster for all the different subsets with even panel of antibody information for the identification and characterization of the subsets for human and mouse dendritic cells, both from tissues and blood. And also another poster for all the different isolation products that are available in our portfolio. And that's because usually when you do a dendritic cell study, you're not only limiting yourself to isolate the dendritic cells, but you also want, for example, to check the T cells, or you want to also study the effect on the B cells or in another compartment of the immune system. And we have products for all of these. So for these, you can check the poster that are that you can find at these two different links. So this is actually kind of an academic approach. This is what you can get from the blood. But let's see more on the clinical side what we can do. So there are different ways also with the in the clinical setting. We can start with the Climax Prodigy that allow for the isolation of the different possibilities, as I will show you in a second. So we have the Climax Prodigy or the Climax Plus, and you can see here a timeline for the process, and we can either start from CD34 progenitors and then differentiation, as I was speaking before. We have an already optimized protocol for the isolation of CD14 positive monocytes and the differentiation and maturation and differentiation to monocyte derived dendritic cells, and finally the loading and final activation of the cells for using in the preparation of cellular products. We also have two different options, one for the PDC and one for the myeloid dendritic cells directly from blood. And in this case, the cells are isolated and then they are cultivated either with IL-3 and other stimulant like these CpGs, TOR receptor, or other antigens. And for the MDC, usually is GM-CSF and antigens. But we also have now a new system that allow the concomitant isolation of the PDC and MDC, and it is our LPBDC system that is not yet released, but it will be very soon released and is under study at the moment, and we will see a little bit about some of these different ways to obtain the dendritic cells further on during the presentation. As you can see, one of the main differences that that is between the MODI-C, that is a classical golden standard for the vaccine protocol preparation, and the primary dendritic cells is in time. So if we think of the classical MODI-C protocol, the classical MODI-C protocol, it's a very, very well-established protocol, and it takes up to 7 to 10 days. To go from the isolation of the monocytes to the final maturation and loading with the antigen. For the blood dendritic cells, or the primary dendritic cells, is a much shorter protocol. It's usually an overnight protocol. You isolate the cells, you incubate them overnight with the antigen and the stimulant or the adjuvant that you want to test, and then you harvest them the day after, and then they're ready for injection. So there is an advantage in this case, that is the time of that it takes to go from the cells to the final product. But let's see a little bit more in particular what I'm speaking about when I speak about the prodigy. So the prodigy is this machine here, and this allows automated generation of dendritic cells in a closed system. So the prodigy have flexible input ports for media and reagents that allow you flexibility if you want to add cytokines, for example, or media. It has a barcode reader for correct recording. This is very important for regulatory purposes, for example. It has a graphing interface that is guiding the operator step by step. There is the magnetic enrichment column that is based on our FDA-approved magnetic separation strategy for the CD34. And we have a closed chamber for cell washing and cultivation of the dendritic cells. And finally, there are sample pouches for quality control that are implemented in the tubing sets depending on the kind of application that you are looking after. So the centrifugal unit is the heart of the prodigy, because it's the item in the prodigy that allow the cell washing, density gradient separation, sample labeling, cell culture, stimulation, antigen loading, all inside the centrifugal unit. And so this is why I call it the heart of the prodigy. And this allow for the complete MODI-C process, for example, to be run into the prodigy from the leukapheresis down to the final maturation and loading stage, but also from buffy coat, or for the blood disease, allow the isolation and cultivation and maturation of the cells overnight. So let's look at some details about the isolation. So in this case, we speak of the clinical scale enrichment for plasmacytoid dendritic cells. In this case, we are using the Clinimax CD304 reagent, or the VDCA4, and this allow the processing of up to 40 per 10 to the 9 cells, with a purity up to 98%, as you can see in the dot plot here, with a very high yield of 51%. So this means that you can start from primary dendritic cells, and this has been used already for trial in melanoma patients, and it has been proven to be of an advantageous therapeutical tool. And we also have the clinical scale enrichment for myeloid dendritic cells. In this case, we are speaking of the Clinimax CD1C or BDCA1 reagent. In this case, there is one extra step, that is the depletion of CD19 positive cells. This is why, this is because CD1C is expressed on B cells, so we need to deplete them from the sample before we enrich for the dendritic cells. And for these, obviously, these are the specificities. Obviously, we start again from 40 per 10 to the 9 total cells, and we can deplete up to 5 × 10⁻⁹ CD19 positive cells. After this, there is a step of enrichment in which the CD1C positive cells are isolated through the magnetic column and bead system. In this case, again, the total cells are 40 × 10⁻⁹ with a capacity of 0.2 × 10⁻⁹ cells. And in this case, as you can see, again, we have a very high purity of 95% and a very high yield for considering the number of cells that we start from and the number of cells that we end up with, because the dendritic cells are very rare cells in the blood. This is a very good average. And as you can see here, the depletion of the B cells is very clean. There is nearly no B cells left. So, and finally, I'm going to introduce you to the LPBDC system. And this is our latest system that is at the moment under use in a trial in melanoma patients. And in this case, we isolate both the plasmacytoid and the myeloid dendritic cells, because it has been published recently and it has been shown that the PDC and MDC can activate themselves and synergize in the activation of their function. And for this reason, we start to develop this particular application. And in this case, we start with a depletion that is not only for the B cells, but also for CD14 positive cells. And in this case, we decided to go for this because there are publications that shows, a very recent publication that show that during the dendritic cells isolation, sometimes you might find some CD14 positive suppressor cells. So these are cells that might inhibit the dendritic cells to exert the activatory function that they need to exert. And for this reason, we decided to include a CD14 depletion step. As you can see again, we can deplete up to 5 × 10⁻⁹ CD19 and CD14 cells and start from 40 × 10⁻⁹ total cells, and the enrichment have very high purity, as you can see here, and a very good recovery and a very high viability. And these are after towing of the product, so this means that it's not calculated just after the isolation, but after the isolation and the freezing of the product. Sometimes, or often, you are not able to use the product immediately because of the quality control that is needed. And so we wanted to test the viability after towing of one of the vials of the product. But now that we know how to get the dendritic cells, let's see some tools that are needed for the vaccine production and quality control. So, as I was saying, we need an antigen to start with, and for that we need to get, for example, a tumor sample. And in this case, I would suggest to use the Gentlemax. Gentlemax is an instrument that standardizes the preparation of tumor lysate as antigen source for dendritic cell vaccination. The feature of the Gentlemax is that it is gentle, and you can receive both viable single cell suspension or use it for lysate production. One of the most important features, especially in preclinical and clinical setting, is that it's reproducible, is automated and standardized, so there is no user dependent issues with it. It is rapid, it allows for a faster and easier than conventional manual methods, and it's safe because the sample processing it happens in a closed and sterile system. If you want more information about Gentlemax and how it can help you in your preclinical or clinical setting, you can find more information following this link here. For cell culture, we provide MaxGMP product as ancillary materials, facilitating the GMP cell manufacture. And these products are following, as you can see, the ISO 9001 and 13485, and are in compliance with the relevant GMP guidelines. They are free of animal and human derived components, and they have an extensive certification of manufacturing and are available as COFA and COO. Importantly, we provide three different grades of cytokines, but mainly for preclinical and clinical study, we would suggest to focus on the max premium grade and the max GMP grade cytokines. These are the same product, but one is obviously packed following all the GMP compliances and guidelines, and it is obviously a bit more expensive for good reasons, but it is the same product as a max premium grade. And so if you're planning to go from preclinical to clinical, we would suggest you to plan ahead and start your basic research with product that you know that you can easily translate from the preclinical stage to the clinical stage. One important product that we also provide is for DC loading, and it's the peptivator peptide pools. The peptivator peptide pools allow you to load the dendritic cells in absence of, for example, a tumor lysis. And these peptide pools are ideal for the efficient in vitro loading of dendritic cells. They're based on a 50-mer. They are designed to be specific for both CD4 and CD8 positive T cells. And the pool contains different 50 mers with an overlap of 11 amino acids. They are available in all three quality grade up to grade up to GMP. They are equivalent or better in stimulation of T cell responses compared to whole antigen. And they have an extensive and actively growing panel of antigens, including viral and tumor-associated antigens, because we are keep producing more and more and translating more from the research catalog to the clinical catalog. For example, we have WT1, PRAME, also Peptivator for CMV and DBV. For more information on the Peptivator, you can click and follow this information, this link. And finally, for quality control of the ATMPs, that is a very, very important point as well. And you will need a flow cytometry for QC and cellular product. Flow cytometry is critical for the quality control. And obviously, we allow you to analyze your cellular product with standardized and tested protocols, because we provide not only the instruments, but we provide antibodies and software and technical service to help you in the development of these tools. So let's dive into some technical detail on the blood dendritic cells in clinical and preclinical applications. So we provide, for example, BDC staining panel and getting strategies for you. So we have an optimized cocktail of antibodies, and here you can see how we use an 8-color staining panel to identify all the different subpopulation of blood dendritic cells. And you start obviously excluding, or we start excluding the dead cells and the getting on CD45, and then you can select the double negative CD14, CD20 cells. So you exclude the monocytes and the B cells with this step. And then you check for CD123 and FCR1 to identify the myeloid dendritic cell population. We decided to go for this because we analyze very carefully all the different antibodies in our portfolio, and these allow for a better discrimination of the two different subpopulations, the MDC and the PDC. And then for the PDC, you stain for CD123 and BDCA2, and these are the BDC. As you can see, the frequencies of the MDCs and the PDCs in human blood is very low. So these are the results that I was showing you before of the isolation, and these you can see a little bit more carefully here. So this is obviously, that was the original fraction, so the dendritic cells in the whole blood, and this is on leukapheresis, and these are the one after isolation. As you can see, there are no monocyte left, there is very little B cells left after the isolation, and we have very high number of MDCs and PDCs. And in fact, we have purity of higher, up to 90%, very good recovery of 61%, and the viability of 87%. So this is why now you are finally allowed to implement primary dendritic cells for therapeutical vaccine production and research, because now you really are able to isolate the dendritic cells from blood. then to show you that the dendritic cells that are so isolated in this way are viable and they are functional, these are some results from the stimulation of the dendritic cells in different conditions. So obviously in black, you can see the cells after isolation but without any treatment. In red, GM-CSF and IL-3. In green, there is protamine RNA that is has been published to be an adjuvant for dendritic cells vaccine. And in blue is a CpGp, that is our T receptor 9 antigen or ligand that we have recently released as a GMP product. So as you can see, the MDC and the PDC in this panel of check with this panel of antibodies, CD86, 83, 80, and CCR7, that are all kind of activation markers or maturation marker for dendritic cells. You can see how the cells are not stimulated by the enrichment process. You can see how they get activated in presence of GM-CSF and IL-3 to a certain extent, especially for CD80, for the planocytoid dendritic cells, apparently there is a little bit of activation. But more importantly, you can see how the addition of an adjuvant like protamine mRNA, or it pushed the activation for both the MODC, then the myeloid disease and the PDC. But especially you can notice how the CpGp give you even a better results, especially for the PDC, not surprisingly, because CpG is recognized by T receptor 9 that is expressed on PDCs. But more interestingly, from this data, you can also see how the recently published synergism of the PDC and MDC in the activation of themselves during an immune response, it's really true. So you can see here how the CD86 is upregulated as after treatment with T receptor 9 in the PDC, but you can see also that the MDCs are highly activated, and this is not because they do recognize T receptor antigen or ligand, because actually they do not express T receptor 9. So this has to be an indirect effect or a synergistic effect of the PDC on the MDCs. So for the analysis of dendritic cells function and the vaccine efficacy, we can really stop at looking only at the dendritic cells. We also need to know if the dendritic cells are activating the T cells that we want. So once we lower the dendritic cells with the antigen, we want to expand specific antigen-specific T cells. But antigen-specific T cells are usually at the limit of detection by conventional techniques, especially for flow cytometry. The number of positive events are incompatible, especially with subset identification. So even if you are able to detect some positive cells, you are not able to identify to which subset they belong. And also the techniques that are used at the moment rely on the in vitro expansion of the T cells. And this risk also to include or skew the original population of the T cells that have been the original population. So we developed specific rapid antigen reactive T cell enrichment kit. This allows for the recognition or the analysis of the T cells activated by an antigen presenting cells in this case, through obviously a specific peptide, and we have a specific tetramer staining with a peptide MHC multimers that associated with a specific selection for CD154 and CD137 allow for the study of the not only the activation of the specific antigens, specific cells, but also the subsets. And now I will show you some results. So using the rapid ARTE, you can enhance the signal-to-noise ratio. As you can see, this one is without enrichment and this one is with enrichment. In this case, it was T cells that have been either left untreated or they were exposed to disease. This is expressing the peptivator for A. fumigatus. And as you can see, you pass from 46 events, 0.04, that are very difficult to be accepted as a real reading, to 2,791 event, the 48.9% after the enrichment for CD154. And this is for obviously stain for anti-TNF-alpha. But also, and finally, rapid RT allow you to allow the characterization of specific subsets, including conventional T cell, regulatory T cells, and standardized solution with gating strategy and antibody panels are designed and ready for you when you use this particular technique. So, and finally, to look at where we are going with the dendritic cells therapy, there is a more with a more standardized and transferable and scalable technology, we can now start to think of future for the ATMP. We will need the definition of more potent protocol for DC manufacturing, not only by the selection of the different tumor antigens or the adjuvant, but also the type of dendritic cells that is used, for example, with a ProCrop. That is a new trial, a multi-trial study that is starting now and is working on the development of potent protocols and also to optimize a vaccination protocols. Obviously, it's important also to optimize the monitoring of the patient and, for example, the route for administration or the timing. It's also important to have combinatorial therapy information on the effect of the dendritic cells associated to other therapeutical tools, for example, immune checkpoint inhibitors. And finally, it would be interesting to also start to implement the dendritic cells monotherapy in earlier stages of disease and in preventive contexts, in which probably the dendritic cells will show their real benefits. So with this, I thank you for your attendance, and I will suggest you to sign up for the next translational webinar. And I want to remind you that we are a global company. We are based for our clinical product in Germany, in Tetero, but we are globally available. So thank you very much for your attention, and if you have any questions, please ask.